Okay, the easiest way is just... Oh, hang on, get out of that. That's okay, if it stays like that, it stays like that. Make enough room for me. So what I do during the sermon, you want one? I don't see that there's anywhere you're going to, because there's nothing weird. So, basically, if the screen shows a responsive thing or a song, you go here.
Shh.
If not, you just go there.
Thank you. Well, good morning and welcome to Trinity United Church, to this our time of worship together. It is so wonderful to see some familiar faces this morning, and we're so delighted that you can join us as well online. Oh, we're getting some waves, that's wonderful. A warm welcome to all who can be with us, whether you're creating a sacred space and carving out some time at home, or whether you can be with us here. We trust that God binds us together in ways beyond our understanding when we come together to worship. We are embarking on a new year. Happy New Year. Today is the first Sunday of Advent, which marks the church new year. And so we will be lighting candles in our countdown to Christmas as we wait in hope for the hope and peace and joy and love that are ours in the birth of Jesus. And so now we invite you to settle in, get cozy, let us prepare our hearts and minds for a time of worship. Invite you to join now in our call to worship. The power of dreams lies in waking up. For when we close our eyes, we see a better world. When we close our eyes, we can dream a better dream. But when we open our eyes, we begin the work of faith. The power of worship is the same. When we enter this time together, we can envision a better world. When we enter this time together, we can dream a better dream. But when we leave this time and space, we begin the work of faith. So be welcome. Dream your dream. Find hope here. For in an hour, together we will begin. Let it be so. Come, let us worship the Lord our God.
Thank you.
Okay. I dream of sunflower fields.
I dream of key lime pie with mile-high meringue.
I dream of the days when we could be part of a crowd.
I dream of snow days and making snow people.
I dream of empty beds in jail cells.
I dream of a world where they will let kids be kids.
I dream of full tables instead of empty bellies.
I dream of schools with enough money to teach.
I dream of parents with enough money to feed.
I dream to keep awake, because if we don't dream of better days, then we might forget that this is not what God imagined.
So today, we light the candle of hope. For hope is the very thing that keeps dreams afloat.
May this light be an invitation to keep awake.
May this light be our invitation to be Advent people, people who dream. Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Original dreamer, over and over again in Scripture, we hear your dream for a beautiful and just world. We hear your dreams for peace and reconciliation. We hear your dream for harmony and togetherness. We hear your dreams for community and hope. We hear your dreams, and yet sometimes we do not open our eyes. We continue to live with the curtains drawn, the covers pulled tight, eyes shut to the realities of the world. Forgive us. Kindle a hope in us that will burn through the darkest nights. Give us the strength and will to keep awake in this sleeping world. With hope we pray. Amen.
Everyone safe. So today I'd like to talk to you a little bit about dreams and dreaming. You know, sometimes when we're awake, we dream about, you know, maybe you're sitting in school, we dream about riding a bike home after school or playing a game with our friends. Sometimes we call those dreams daydreams, and they're quite nice. Sometimes when we're asleep, you know, we also dream, and sometimes we dream really nice dreams when we're sleeping too. Like we dream about, you know, swimming in a lake in the summer or going on a car ride with our parents. But then there's other times when we're sleeping that dreams can be scary, you know. Maybe we're lost somewhere, or we think maybe there's a monster sleeping under our bed. And those dreams wake us up. But you know, that's a good thing, because when you wake up, then you get to see where you really are. And when you wake up, it is dark in your bedroom, and then that can be scary too. So maybe you cry out, and then first thing you know, the door to your room opens, in come your parents, they rush over to your bed, they pick you up and hug you, they tell you it's okay, and then they turn on the light and you can see where you are. You're in your own bedroom, you're on your own bed, you're not lost, and all your stuffies are there all around you. Like this is where you live and sleep. And then you can look under the bed and there's no monster there, no. So then your parents tuck you back in and put your blanket up around you and you can just go off to sleep again, knowing that you're safe. I brought my blanket today. You know, you think that maybe only kids like blankets, you know, to drag around the house and take to bed at night, but so do adults, at least in our house, the adults do. We like these blankets, you know, wrap them around us like this when we're cold. You know, when Jesus was just born, the first thing his parents did was wrap him in a blanket. And then they placed him in a nice, warm place. And then they just sat and looked at him and watched him to make sure that he was safe. And you know, all children should feel safe. But you know, some don't. But you know, maybe there's a way that people like you and me and the people who are sitting here today, maybe there's a way we can help. Maybe we can buy them a new blanket or a new stuffy for their bedroom, you know? Maybe we could write a little note to them that says, God loves you, and so do we. Maybe that would make them feel safe, and that would be a good thing, because everyone needs to feel safe. And maybe we could pray for those kids right now. Let's do that. This is a repeat after me prayer.
This is a repeat after me prayer.
Hello, God. We are so thankful for all the people and places and things in our life. That make us safe. We pray that more people will wake up and notice that many children are not safe and don't have the things we have. And maybe they will reach out to children now. Amen.
Thank you.
Our first scripture reading for today is taken from Isaiah 64, verses 1 to 9. Oh, that you would hear, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to our adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father, we are the clay, you are our potter. We are the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember our iniquity forever. Now consider, we are your people. May God bless this reading to our understanding.
Come all ye men,
Our second scripture reading for today is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 13, verses 32 to 37 in the New Revised Standard Version. The coming of the Son of Man. But in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. The lesson from the fig tree. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. The necessity for watchfulness. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight, or at cockcrow or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all. Keep awake. Let us pray. O great dreamer, you dreamed up the stars in the sky. You dreamed up that magic baby smell and the way cream sinks into coffee. You dreamed up the crunch of fall leaves and jazz music. And in the midst of all of that, you dreamed a dream for your people, a dream for hope of justice, hope and justice, a dream for eyes wide open to both the world's suffering and the world's beauty. So today, as we have read your scripture and we consider it together, we ask that you would plant that same dream in us. Pour out your spirit now on our hearts and minds, that we may see what you see and dream what you dream. Gratefully we pray. Amen. Well, my first message that comes clear out of this passage is you better stay awake during the sermon today. It's clear. I think it was about four times that it says, keep awake, so, you know, may that echo in your minds. No pressure, it's okay. I'll do my best to keep you awake, but no pressure. But actually, what the passage made me first think of was, did anyone in elementary school ever have a teacher say these blessed few words? Now, class, I'll be right back, and I'll expect things to be just this way when I return. Right. That was like a hall pass. Clever little ones we were. We were able to be quite organized as the elementary years went on. Soon as teacher was out of sight, it was all coordinated. One or two would keep watch at the door. You know, they'd keep watch for when teacher would be returning, while the rest of us would, you know, maybe we'd switch seats or grab a snack or play with the pointer or the chalk. And then as soon as, you know, we got the word that teacher was on his or her way back, you know, everyone would scurry back, and it was like he or she never knew, right? Right, they never knew. Cheeky little ones we were. But I was reminded of this scenario when I first read Mark's gospel, where Jesus invites us to keep watch, or keep awake as one who is waiting at the door, not knowing when to expect the return and the coming of God. One does not know when. For some, this passage is viewed as an apocalyptic text, one that predicts the end times, which Mark 2,000 years ago seemed to believe was imminent and would not, a generation would not go by without that happening. For some, they believe that that Jesus is pointing to his resurrection, actually, because Mark is writing about those end last days of Jesus and saying, believe me, it's not going to end this way, and pointing to Jesus' resurrection, rather. Either way, these scriptures are part of a larger narrative, a pattern that we can find in the Bible. In trying times when cruel regimes were taking over and having the upper hand, the scripture writers would envision an imminent future in which God would directly come to the rescue in a magnificent, spectacular fashion. And they would describe these occurrences with extravagant, evocative, often natural visions of hope, where the natural world would erupt in some way. When all hope seemed lost, they would predict and prophesy these magnificent happenings, and it's all through scripture. We see it today in Isaiah's prophecy, when he's asking, pleading for such a thing to happen, for a sign of hope to come, for God to open up the heavens and make the mountains quake, to let adversaries know that God is with the people. In Mark's gospel reading today, we see this pattern echoed as well. Mark writes, "But in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory." These wondrous signs that they sought and prophesied were written in very dark and difficult times. The backdrop was Jesus' last days, as I mentioned, which we know would be incredibly dark and difficult, but not without a surprise ending. And it's also believed that Mark was writing this at a time 70 years after Jesus' death, reflecting back, writing during a time of a disastrous Jewish revolt against the Roman imperial occupation in Palestine. And so at that time, it's understood that Rome's power and vengeance had shook Mark's reality to the core. The imperial armies just wiped out the people there. They defeated the rebellion and destroyed the temple, which for the Jews was incredibly sacred and was nothing less than the sacred heart of their world. So the message of Mark's gospel is thus a message of hope, proclaimed against the backdrop of nothing but catastrophe. And to really hear it, we need to position ourselves in a place alongside that desolation, that chaos, that bewilderment. To listen alongside what would have been the traumatized soldier that he was speaking to, the displaced refugee, the heartbroken child, the exhausted nurse, the mourning mother. This is where Mark lives when he writes this. These are the depths with which he writes. And I don't know about you, but all of this might seem like a little heavy to begin our Advent journey, you know. Being the church new year, perhaps it might be, you know, more appropriate to celebrate and to toast, and you know, maybe a lighthearted passage could be nice when you think about hope. Yet it is fitting because to really look for hope, you need to be in a place where you understand that it's needed. We too are living in a time that is new and difficult territory, especially for us in the so-called first world, who aren't necessarily used to being inconvenienced to this degree. We live amid the backdrop of a fierce virus claiming livelihoods and lives all over the globe, putting nurses and teachers in survival mode, separating us from people and places we hold dear, inciting fear and division, which further isolate us from one another. We also live amid the backdrop of a resurgence of neo-Nazi followers, amid fights for justice, Black Lives Matter movement, women's movements, women's rights movements all over the world, protests erupting globally. And so amid that backdrop, it makes sense to search for signs of hope. If not riding on a cloud or breaking through the heavens or falling from the sky, where do we find signs of hope today? Emily Dickinson famously imagined hope as the thing with feathers, perching gently in every human soul, singing, how poetic. The image is likewise meaningful for a congregant who is at home today, who this week in our Advent study group expressed how he felt it was a sign of hope when a woodpecker landed right near his face just as he was changing the feeder. He felt that was a sign of hope breaking through. For me, my tot reminds me to be hopeful. No sooner will I think, oh great, a train. We are definitely going to be late, that he will say, Mama, look, train, train, choo-choo, or oh great, construction, we're doomed now. He will say, Mama, truck, truck, look, look, Mama, and he will just be trying to climb out of his seat. Now, hope is different from just optimism. It's different from just looking for an optimistic, you know, point of view. It's deeper than that, and in the readings today, there was real reason, there was real precedent to need that hope. It can come through in small ways like a fluttering bird, but sometimes the kind of hope that we're seeking, or the kind of hope that certainly the gospel writers were seeking, was the kind of hope that would transform the world in which we live. For the kind of hope that would tear down barriers, break down walls, transform people, transform systems, transform the world. I recently read about a remarkable story like that of Bishop Leonard Wilson. On his return to Britain at the end of the Second World War, Bishop Wilson expressed his understanding of hope on the radio. Like many others, he had been tortured in the Japanese concentration camp called Changi Jail in Singapore. The Japanese had taken turns torturing him for an extended period of time and had seemingly enjoyed their cruelty, thinking it quite justified. And so on the radio, Bishop Wilson reflected, by the grace of God, I imagined those men not as they were then, but as they had been. Once they were little children with their brothers and sisters, happy in their parents' love, in those far-off days before they had been conditioned by their false nationalistic ideas. And it is hard to hate little children. So I imagined them not as they were in the present, but as they were, and also as they were capable becoming by the transformative power of Christ. This hope is different from the optimism, like I mentioned with my toddler, though that's hopeful as well. But Bishop Wilson has made the choice to dream of a better future, to wait for God to break through, to allow that hope to transform his reality even then. It's a hope that waits for God to transform reality, to confront evil, and restore humanity. It echoes the narratives that we see in our scriptures today of the prophet Isaiah dreaming of a better day, of Jesus in Mark's gospel casting a vision of the dawning hope, inviting us to keep awake for its arrival. As Bishop Wilson dreamed of his aggressors as children who could be taught a better way, as my son sees joy when I see a hurdle, as a congregant saw hope in a bird's visit, as another congregant remarked this week in our study group, there seems to be more people putting their lights out a little earlier this year. Similar to earlier in the pandemic when people would put signs of hope in their windows. My neighborhood was full of people who'd painted and put up artwork and so on, messages of encouragement and hope in their windows. All of these are signs of hope, and we are called to keep awake to them all around us. And we're called to not only see the hope and wait for the hope that will transform, but to be the hope, to live into the hope that we are promised. Reading over today's passages about keeping awake, I was reminded of an expression from the vernacular of the Black Lives Matter movement. And you may have heard it expressed, woke. You know, stay woke. Being woke essentially means to be aware of and willing to be in solidarity with people who are pushed to the margins of society because of systemic oppression of all kinds. Being willing to stand with the kinds of people Jesus stood beside. To be the dreamers of today on the shoulders of the dreamers of yesterday, such as the one who said, "I have a dream," Martin Luther. To bring dreams into real time. And we start all of this keeping awake here and now in such a trying time as this. For it's precisely here that God's grace will break through. And accordingly, it's precisely here that the church is called to light candles of hope and peace and joy and love against this backdrop that we have today of hate and violence, and illness, and suffering, and poverty. It's worth remembering this deep poetic reality. As the Christian New Year begins, we enter this darkness, waiting, singing, and praying anew for the light. I'll close this morning with this morning's sermon with a little poetry, two short ones. First, a poem written by an unknown author during World War II. It was found on the wall of a cellar, written by a Jew in a concentration camp in Cologne. I believe in the sun, even when it's not shining. And I believe in love, even when there's no one there. And I believe in God, even when he is silent. And finally, as the African-American poet Langston Hughes writes, Hold fast to dreams. For if dreams die, life is like a broken-winged bird that cannot fly.
Saying, you know, there's nothing going to be happening this month. You know, it's just, there's can't do anything, can't really meet with anybody, and, you know, it's going to be kind of a lonely month. But then when I look at the roster for Trinity and what's happening here, it seems like there's a lot going on at Trinity. We're pretty busy here. Beginning today, group one or cohort, yeah, group one people, group one. Not cohort one. Following the service, John Bowman is going to go out there and open the trunk of our car. And if you brought things for the toy and food drive, you could place them in the trunk right after the service. And then on Tuesday, he will take them down to community care. I have a feeling Marilyn Snedden, who was gathering the gifts last week for group two, that she's already taken hers to community care. But if you have not prepared yourself for today but would still like to contribute, you can phone the office tomorrow and if you have some things, or if you're one of the people who's watching online today, call the office and Heather Brady and Tanya will come right by your house sometime on Tuesday and pick up your things and take them to community care as well. So everything should be at community care by Tuesday. And that, in a way, will complete our food and toy drive for 2020. I'd like to also, though, add that Soul Sisters has made up a lovely big hamper for a local family. It seems, according to community care, that things are a little bit thin this year. I know a lot of people are feeling the pinch. There are perhaps more names for requests for hampers than other years, and then maybe just a little bit less coming in because of the way that the economy has affected many in our community. I've also been asked for the return to church committee, or by the return to church committee, to remind you that when you leave the service, please go directly out. I know how tempting it is when you see someone you haven't seen for a while and you just want to start talking to them, maybe in the aisle here or in the narthex, but that's exactly the situation that seems to be the most dangerous when you're sharing your breath with another person. It's not a good idea. I'm just thinking what they used to say or yell at us in the halls in high school. No loitering in the halls. That's kind of where we're at. Other things going on at Trinity this week, they're all virtual. Right after the service today, coffee and conversation at 11:45. The link is there. And you can have a little chat with some others who watched it perhaps virtually, and it's nice to hear their impression too. Tomorrow night, or Tuesday night, Creative Spirit at 7 p.m. Those people, the people who are taking that with Carolyn Campbell, I know they're having wonderful experience. And then Wednesday, there's an Advent study going on, and you have a choice of when you would like to key in, 1 p.m. or 6 p.m. And that sounds like a really interesting program because you talk about some of the themes of Advent, but also do a little bit of research into some of the most beloved Christmas carols and what was the original premise for writing them. And then, moving on, still virtually, a longest night service on December the 21st, that would be the Monday evening before Christmas. This is a solemn, very thoughtful service. The Christmas season is always such, you know, there's always so much hype and excitement and joy and things like that. And some years, not just this year, but some years, maybe you haven't had the greatest year. Maybe somebody close to you died. Maybe you lost your job. Maybe something is going wrong somewhere. And you really aren't feeling like you want to be part of all this good stuff that's going on. So this is a time to just sit and to ponder and to remember that God is with us in the good times and the bad. And then the Christmas Eve services, which unfortunately we have to say have to be virtual as well. But we're going to try our very best to offer you a very upbeat, joyful family service and then later a candlelight service with communion. And these services will be available online. The family service will be available anytime after 3 p.m. and the candlelight service available anytime after 6 p.m. And then one last thing, and it's not virtual, this is the good stuff. Okay, out on the lawn here, there is a Christmas tree, and it's got the lights are all there and in place, and they're going to turn them on December the 1st, so that's always a fun experience or a good thing to see. Unfortunately, we can't gather and have hot chocolate and do all those usual things. And also, the Advent words are out there now. Hope, peace, joy, and love are displayed on the lawn, and this year we're focusing on the theme of hope. And when you see that word hope out there, you realize we're focusing on the theme of hope. The property committee has made quite a display. And the nice thing is you can walk by or drive by, and you can just go up on the lawn and look at them. And you can even touch them because they're real. They're not virtual. Okay, well, that kind of concludes the announcements, but can lead us naturally then into a time of Thanksgiving. We're entering a season of gift giving, and we would like to thank you for the generosity that you have shown to Trinity during the pandemic. I know many of you who are watching today from your homes, you feel it is too risky for you to come to these in-person services, and yet you continue to give and to help keep this church afloat so that we can give back to our community and also to the world through your givings to the Mission and Service Fund. So thank you for all that you have been doing. The pandemic has had mixed reactions in terms of its economic effects. Some businesses have thrived as never before, but others have been devastated as never before, and the trickle-down effect is really causing hardships to some employees. So we thank you for the support you have given to the toy drive and the food drive and to the Christmas hampers. It is our hope that they will bring a measure of joy to families and singles in our community. This is the work we are called to do, the work that brings peace and justice. They represent the love of our heart and the generosity of our spirit. We are so grateful that we have them to share with others. It is our hope that they will be of benefit to those who receive them. We ask this in the name of Jesus, whose coming brought hope and continues to bring hope for all people in their times of helplessness and hopelessness. Amen. I was looking through this book I have, If Darwin Prayed by Bruce Sanguin. It says, Prayers for Evolutionary Mystics. And I saw in here the most beautiful prayer that I would like to offer now. And I have a short one I have written more for our context afterwards, but anyways, I think it'd be better if I just end it first with a word Amen, and then I will continue on with the next. Let us pray. O Holy One, we are a sleepy lot, slow to stir to the calling of the cosmos, deaf to the cries of earth and the forgotten ones, human and other than human. We distract ourselves with trivialities that have become idols. While the sun and the moon darken and the stars fall from the skies, we are mesmerized by the market's alluring power, eyes unflinchingly fixed upon the navel of our own net worth. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, cries the prophet. Or at least tear open our hearts, pry open our eyes, and end this slumber that blocks out pain, but with it wonder. Our hope, O Holy One, is found in eyes wide open, in hearts linked in common cause, in small gestures of compassion, and in alertness to your coming again and again. As fire kindles brushwood and causes water to boil, so we await to be set on fire with hope and gospel passion. Amen. Let us continue with our prayers for today. Holy One, as we enter the season of Advent, our eyes are open to the familiar signs of Christmas, twinkling lights adorning the houses and streets where we live, scrumptious delicacies, decadent chocolate offerings in grocery stores and bakeries, greenery decorated with red bows and glitter in hallways of retirement homes and long-term care facilities. Still, it's different this year, very different. The virus that threatens to ravage our bodies is already attacking our anticipation of the heartwarming season to which we have become accustomed. We are left without hope of hugs from family, visits from friends, open houses and choir pageants. Come into our hearts, our minds and our dreams, Holy One. Inspire us with imaginative ideas of how we can reach out to those who are struggling from illnesses over which they have little control, or those who will be alone, perhaps for the first time. May we who are able be the answer to their dreams, to their need for love and companionship. Holy One, despite our concerns, our fears, our sense of hopelessness at this time, we remember now your presence that has sustained the people of the world through times of famine, resettlement, wars, plagues, depressions, and other economic downturns. Awareness of your continuing presence through the ages provides the hope we need for today. Thank you so, so very much. And now, with Jesus, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Thank you.
And now, as you go from this time together, may you continue to ponder God's dreams for you and yours and for all of humanity. May the Spirit comfort you when dreams turn into nightmares. May Jesus, who walked this world to wake us up, stir you to follow in his footsteps, in your circle, in your community, in this world. As you go now to begin the work of faith, know that you go always with the peace and power and presence of God. Amen.